Hi everyone, and welcome to the HiFi Turtle YouTube channel. I'm HiFi Turtle, and today I'm going to be reviewing the Dali Spektor 1 bookshelf speaker. This speaker was loaned to me for this review by my local Dali dealer, Simply Stereo. Check the description for their website and socials. The Dali Spektor 1 retails for $249. For those of you who are not familiar with Dali, Dali stands for Danish Audiophile Loudspeaker Industries. Now, these Dalis, with their price, are made in China, but I don't think that distracts from the quality at all. Let's talk about the sound of these speakers. This speaker is capable of producing loud, strong, big sound that can fill a room, despite their size, which is really surprising. Let's run through the basics of the speaker. The bass. The bass is not hard-hitting. It's not a subwoofer. It's not meant to be like that. The bass is very punchy. It's very tight. It is not overwhelming. It's not going to bowl you over, but it is very good. There are a few tracks I like to reference when it comes to bass frequency. The first being Into the Void by Nine Inch Nails. Now, in the beginning of the song, there's a bass drum that is dead center in the image, and it's boom, boom, boom. And it hits with great power, great sound, great recording, beautiful. On these speakers, it's good. You get that bass punch. You get the good idea of that bass drum. It is not a fully fleshed out bass, but it is very good, especially for a speaker of this size and price. It will get you the majority of the sound that is there and can be listened to. Going to bass heavy music, such as hip hop, you still get a good bass presence. There's a lot of fun here. I found that if you bump up in equalization, the bass frequency, maybe 3 to 6 dB, you actually do get a lot of bass out of these speakers, and it's a lot of fun. Both listening to these in my main reference room, which is fully treated, the bass was really fun, a lot of weight with that equalization. In my home office, which I thought these were better suited for, and for my personal use, I would use them in that kind of situation, either as a home office or gaming speaker. These were a lot of fun. And I think with that equalization, if you can get it, will give you a lot of what you're looking for in that kind of setup. Let's talk about the mid-range. The mid-range is great. This is where the speaker, I think, really shines, is in the mid-range. When I think of great mid-ranges, I think of very chesty vocal reproduction. A song that I like that has that chesty vocal is Exile by Taylor Swift, but it features Bonavir. And when Bonavir comes out in that song, his voice hits you like a freight train. It is so chesty, so deep. It's unbelievable. It's a great sounding song. And the image of his voice is dead center as well. These are great at reproducing that. There's a lot of weight in Bonavir's voice. It's not the weight that you'd get from a floor stander. It's not the weight you're going to get from a much more expensive speaker. But once again, for the size and price of these speakers, you are getting most of the way there. You are getting a great center image. You're getting a great chestiness to that vocal. It's not fully to the point where you can say Bonavir is in that room, but it's very, very close. And it images incredibly well. Full chest, great chestiness, great detail, really wonderful on vocal tracks, really wonderful on this track especially. Let's talk about the treble. When I first heard these speakers, I thought they were bright. And if you follow me on Instagram, I did a little mini review of these speakers. I really did like them and said so, but I thought they were bright. And I listened to them on the Blue Sound Power Note, which is a Class D amplifier. It's an all-in-one unit. And I thought the brightness might be at fault of that component. Now, in my reference room, I'm listening to these on the Hagel H20, which is a Class AB amplifier and delivers over 200 watts per channel. And that amplifier, to me, is a true reference. It has a lot of bottom end weight. It has very good detail, very fleshed out detail. When I heard it for the first time, I knew it was the amp that I had to buy for my reference system. To me, that amp is very detailed, has high resolution, great extension on both the high and bottom end. When I first put these in my room, I still thought they were bright, and I thought, oh no, they're just too bright. They're too bright. I don't know if I can recommend them. Now, I had them towed in the same way that I have my Focals towed in. And I said, well, with this kind of brightness, usually it's a positioning thing. So I went on the Dali website, and Dali actually recommends that their speakers are not towed in at all. They recommend this, the speakers fire straight into the room. Now, when I still had them towed in, I noticed that the off-axis response really smoothed out that brightness that I wasn't enjoying. Before I even went on the Dali website, I was going to recommend these speakers, but just having them positioned off-axis. Now, firing them straight into the room did exactly the same thing for me. And having them fired directly into the room, I didn't feel like there was any loss in the mid-range or bass or image quality. So firing them straight is the recommendation by Dali, and I think it shows by the listening as well that this is the correct way to position these speakers, is to have them just right into the room with no toe-in. Let's talk about the soundstage of the speaker. The soundstage I thought was pretty narrow. These speakers are about 5 feet apart in my listening room, and having a speaker less than 6 feet apart can affect the imaging soundstage, but I thought that these still imaged very well with the voice straight in the center, exactly where it should be, and I used a couple songs to see how deep and how expansive the soundstage really is. The first song I like to use to explore the soundstage is Watching TV by Roger Waters. This song has a TV in the very beginning, and the TV ideally should be directly left of you. And listening to this song on a pair of speakers really gives you an idea of how good their image is going to be based on where you hear the TV is in the room. As soon as this song came on and I heard the TV, I was really surprised because the TV was actually very deep in the room. It was very left. It's not as deep as my Focals, but it's deep. It's there. It's where it should be. And that really surprised me. Another song I like to show how 3D and expansive the soundstage really is The Cover of Orion by Rodrigo y Gabriela. And this song has a lot of moving parts. It has a lot of instruments. There's a beautiful sit-down drum in the very beginning, and then the guitar hits you, the bass hits you. There's bongos. There's a lot of drums, a lot of instruments to this song, and they're all very well defined and recorded. And throughout the song, those instruments move. So that gives you an idea of the soundstage, the image quality, the expansiveness, the 3D-ness of that soundstage. Now, listening to that song, there's a part where the drum travels from the left side of the room and keeps going and going and going to the right side of the room. On the Spektor 1, the image was there, but it wasn't fully fleshed out. It wasn't fully 3D. It was this more kind of 2D soundstage. It was wide enough to where the instruments do stick out and form their own little area in the room. Not so much as to when that drum starts to move across the room, you feel like someone's actually playing a drum and moving from one side of the room to the other. It's more of just the speaker is changing from the left channel to the right channel versus a 3D soundstage where you can tell where that person is in the room and is moving behind the speakers, like a live acoustic experience. That being said, I still don't fault these speakers for that kind of soundstage because it's still good. It still does at the very base what it's supposed to do. And for $249 and a speaker of this size, it's still very good for what it is. Let's talk about the type of sound. Now, the Spektor 1 is more forward, in my opinion. It was more analytical. I felt like the speaker, when it was playing, was not playing on the plane that the speaker was positioned at, but more so maybe 2-3 feet in front of that. It really gives you that front of the room, first row kind of sound that I personally really enjoy. And I thought this was a great speaker because of that. When I evaluate speakers, when I think about the positioning of that soundstage as far as how forward it is into the room, I really value that because I like that forward sound. I like that analytical sound. And when something's too far laid back, it just doesn't hit me the same way. So I really like that these were more forward. These were more analytical. And it was really an enjoyable listening experience. As I mentioned earlier, I played this in two different rooms. In my main reference room, which is fully treated and has high-end electronics. And then in my home office, which is not treated, and I replaced my high-end electronics with a Yamaha receiver. Now, the Yamaha receiver is about $900, so it is not a low-end component. It's a mid-range component. It is an all-in-one. So I was using the digital outs from my computer to go to the Yamaha, and then the Yamaha just to the speakers. Now, compared to my reference system, was not as detailed, not as fully fleshed out, a little more muddy, I would say, but comparatively to my reference system, which is many thousands of dollars, the Yamaha performed pretty good, I thought. And in that home office situation where I'm not going to have full separates and extremely large separates, I thought it was perfectly fine. If you have a smaller space, the Blue Sound Power Note is a great pairing with the speaker as well. In my home office, I had these still about 5 feet apart, just on the ends of the desk. And because it's a desk, I was only a couple feet behind the speaker. So that image, while it was still there, was not the same kind of image I'm getting in my reference room. And I actually got more bass because my desk is up against the wall, and these being rear ported probably added a 3 decibel bump to that, to the low end. That bass bump was enjoyable for things like games, movies, just overall enjoyment of the music versus critical analytical listening, which I would reserve for my main reference room. So overall, I think the Dali Spektor 1 is a really great speaker. I think for $249, you're going to be really hard pressed to find something better than these. And very friendly speaker. They're small. You can fit them pretty much anywhere. Home office, gaming setup, soundbar replacement, main listening room, whatever it may be, you can find a place for these speakers because of their size and still have a full, enjoyable listening experience.